But this week and the next week, we are going to be studying parts of Surah Sad. Parts of Surah Sad. Surah Sad, Surah number 38, right? Surah number 38 of the Quran. And this is in a continuation of a program I'm doing online for the tafsir. We started, I think, Shafir or Surah Saffat, Surah Yasin. And it's available on YouTube in Epic Islamic Lectures. Epic Islamic Lectures, one word. If you go to YouTube channel, Epic Islamic Lectures, it has hundreds and hundreds of lectures for different scholars, mashallah. And it has my lectures on the tafsir of Al-Quran from Surah Yasin. So when I was overseas, I missed a couple of sessions. So inshallah, for the benefit, I'm doing them, and inshallah, will everybody benefit from. But if you want before and after, inshallah, go to Epic Islamic Lecture, and you will find the continuation of this program. But in this masjid, inshallah, this week and next week only for Surah Sad. Then after that, Thursdays, as we were doing the seerah, we will do another program, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. So it will be in the announcement of the masjid. Just wanted you to know why we are doing this. I will give a brief summary of the introduction of Surah Sad, the relationship with the Surah As-Saffat, the theme of the surah. Then we will do verses 27 to 40, right? 29? Verses 29 to 40, inshallah, of the sunnah, of the surah. My assistant, Brother Abdul Sabur, so he's going to be doing that. So Surah Sad is a Surah Makkiyah. Surah Makkiyah means it is revealed to Rasulullah ﷺ before the migration to Medina, and it is 88 ayahs. 88 ayahs according to the Ad Makki or the count, Ad Kufi or the Kufi numbering of the ayat. 27 to 40, inshallah. So this surah is 88 ayahs. It is called Surah Sad because it starts with that letter. And there are many surahs that starts with letters. This is one of the surah starts with a letter, one letter only, like Sad and Noon, example. There are surahs that start with two letters, like Taha and Yasin, Hamim, those two letters. There are surahs that start with three letters, like Alif Lam Mim and Alif Lam Ra. There are surahs that start with four letters, like Alif Lam Mim Sad, or Alif Lam Mim Ra. There are surahs that start with five letters, like Hamim, Ain, Sin, Qaf. And there are surahs that start with six letters, like Kaf, Ha, Ya, Ain, Sad. Those are surahs that start with letters, right? So this is one of the surahs that starts with? One, Sad, and it's called Surah Sad. Like Surah Al-Qalam, Surah Noon, also one of the names. So Surah Sad. How this surah is related to the surah before it? Saffat, Surah As-Saffat. Saffat means the wing extenders, means like the angels extend their wing when they're flying, or the birds extending their wing flying, right? So Surah As-Saffat is that surah, also Makki surah. Relationship of this surah to the surah before it. At the end of Surah As-Saffat, Allah Azza wa Jal talked about the disbelievers, saying, if we have something like the people before, revelation, يعني, لو أن عندنا ذكرا من الأولين لكنا عباد الله المخلصين. If we have a revelation like the people before, we would have been chosen ones too. Quraysh said that. Then Allah gave them the Quran, still they rejected. So Surah Sad, Sad, والقرآن ذي الذكر. You want this? Here you go. So this surah is relating to Surah As-Saffat from that. Also from that perspective. The other perspective, Surah As-Saffat has the mentioning of certain prophets. Nuh alayhi salam, you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam, stories. Surah Sad comes to mention few other prophets. There are few examples like this in the Quran. Surah An-Naml comes after Surah Al-Shu'ara. Surah Al-Shu'ara starts with prophets, and Surah An-Naml finishes the prophets. Right? You have Surah Taha, mentioned Musa alayhi salam and a couple of prophets, and Surah Al-Anbiya, mentioned Surah Taha, and then Surah Maryam, and then Surah Al-Anbiya, prophets, prophets, prophets. Right? So it's like that. Surah Hud, and then Surah Yusuf alayhi salam comes. Like that. So there are examples in the Quran like this. A surah talk about prophets, and then the following surah comes and talk about the rest of the prophets. So Sa'd and Saffat, they are relating from that perspective. What is the theme or the subject matter of Surah Sa'd? Like all Makki surahs, the fundamentals of Aqeedah of the Muslim, belief in Allah and the hereafter, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the angels and so on. Tawheed, yani, oneness of Allah, prophethood of Rasulullah and the resurrection. Remember those three, right? Relating to Allah, prophethood of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, resurrection and what happens thereof. Those three. Remember, what are the fundamentals of your aqeedah, your belief? Yes, you believe in many things, right? But what are the fundamentals of your aqeedah? The tawheed of Allah Azza wa Jal, His names and attributes, and who's Allah and what Allah is able for, what the names of the meaning of those attributes, discussions, and who deviated and who did that. You know, all of this a science by itself, right? But it revolves around that principle, fundamental, asli of the deen, one of the fundamentals of your aqeedah, right? Second one is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Taban, all the prophets, who the prophet and the messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the proofs of his prophethood, the miracles, and what the prophet can do, what the prophet cannot do, can the prophet commit a sin or not commit a sin, major or minor, you know, many other things, right? And what is the sunnah and the hadith and the a'mal of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you love him, and what is his status, and where you cannot pass, exceed, and you cannot go below, you know, all of these things. So prophethood of prophets. And then ba'ath, we will die, and after death what's going to happen, and your ruh, and then the grave, and then the resurrection, and the balance, and the scale, and the sirat, and the jannah, and the nar, and ashab al-a'raf, and what happened, all of this is ba'ath, right? So this is the principle. So this surah is no different. This surah is no different. It has that subject matter, and how these things are introduced through a debate, a discussion, a response to the doubts and the claims of the mushrikeen. And that's the style of the Quran. They say such and such, and the truth is such and such. They ask you about this, and the answer is like this. Allah Azza wa Jal is giving this interactive, subhanAllah, way of responding to the claims and the doubts. And this is a lesson for us. This is a lesson for us. It is not just a template. You know, some people sometimes take the deen as templates. And that's what causes problems. You know, template? A template means you take the template, someone says something, says, hola, like this, kufr, shirk, you know, like a template. And then if somebody come and ask you like a smart question, frozen, you know, I don't know. Right? Then you give this service to the religion. Now, okay? So this is very important to know how the Quran addresses that. How the Quran addresses that. Subhanallah, Allah says, look at the sun, look at the moon, look at the sky. Reasoning. Reasoning, right? There is a God. Who is that God? What do you think? يَوْمِ الْحِسَابِ أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَفَحَسِبَ الَّذِينَ. You know, do you think like this? What do you, subhanallah, it's always like intriguing the person, you know, trying to, but firm in the faith. No compromise. But you have to be really, really well versed on what you do before you go to that argument and the debate. So Quran, Surah Sa'd does that. So the surah starts with giving the negative description of those who disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They denied the oneness of Allah. They denied the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They denied the hereafter. And you go back, inshallah, to the lecture, and we talked about those in details. So there are three claims in which they denied that Allah is able to do certain things, that Prophet Muhammad is a prophet. أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا, means there should be no one God. Astaghfirullah, يعني. That is denying of Allah deserving to be one God, right? Then they denied the prophethood of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. ألقي عليه الذكر من بين يعني why he's chosen like this. So they denied. And then they denied the hereafter. وقالوا ربنا عجل لنا قطنا قبل يوم الحساب. If there is a hereafter, bring it on now, man. Bring it on now. We want it to go now. So mocking it. So those three in the same first page of the surah. The rest of the surah is to answer all three. Subhanallah. And this is again a style. You have to acknowledge the claims. You are saying such and such and such. Did they hear you right? Yes. Do you mean such and such? Yes. Then you answer. Okay? Because if you answer, you say, oh, no, that's not what I meant. And then take you somewhere else. Those are arts of debates, huh? So sometimes, you know, you go and, you know, you jump on the response. Then the person said, when he found himself cornered, he said, no, that's not what I meant, man. No. After you give all what is in with you, right? Everything in your pocket, you spilled it out already, right? Then he knows now you are out of ammunition. They said, no, that's not what I meant. And he bring you another doubt. Make you spin around. Then it's very important. And they teach that here, you know, they teach that. When you do, you know, advanced degrees, they teach that. You should always affirm. Whenever someone is debating or arguing or is that important thing, say, do you mean such a thing? Did I hear you right? Let me paraphrase what you said. If I understood you correct, you are saying 1, 2, 3. Yes, yes, here is your answer. Cannot get out of it now. All right, so that is, subhanAllah, the style of surahs, right? They say this, they say this, they say this. Imagine now Rasulullah SAW is reciting it for them. None of them said, oh, I didn't say that. None. Okay? Then the answer comes. What are you going to... Yeah, we said this. So, okay, here is your answer. SubhanAllah. Then Allah Azza wa Jal gives the qasas or the stories of the prophets before. Now, Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, nobody could bring proof that he learned this from anyone. So someone who can give you all this news of the past has to be true for the future as well. And if he knew all of that, then means he have all this knowledge of humanity. He tells you where it's going. Where is it going? So that's one way as well. Then Allah Azza wa Jal also mentioned the story of Adam alayhi salam. And the one who has the beginning is the one who controls the end. And beyond as well. And then the surah at the end talking about the sincerity of Rasulullah ﷺ, and he's not seeking any dunya or any reward or any compensation in this dunya from anyone for the message. And this is actually a proof of the true prophethood. True prophethood. And when he comes, they said, oh, he has an agenda, means he wants to rule, authority. He said, I'm not interested in your positions. I'm not interested. If I one day run for any election or run for positions, don't listen to me anymore. خلاص. So this is out of the deal. Oh, he wants to be famous. I don't want to be famous. You take the credit, man. You know, I will go to you know, invite you. You become Muslim, you stay king. You stay president, you stay whatever you want. So you want money? ما أسألكم عليه أجرا. لا أسألكم عليه أجرا. I don't want money from anyone. So what you want? I just want to present the message. And you have the choice. It does not come more simple than that, does it? So that is the proof of true prophethood. That's why when Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu, before he became a Muslim, when he went to the king of the Roman, you know, Heraclius, the king of the Roman, and he asked him, did he ask for money? He said, no. Did anyone before him, he said, no, did that? Did he want fame? No. Who follows him? The poor people or the rich people? He asked him a few questions, and he said, all this means he's a prophet. Even a non-Muslim, you know, he said, this is a prophet. Nobody does that except a prophet. Everyone else have a personal benefit somehow. Now we go to our ayahs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah 27, right? وَمَا خَلَقْنَا السَّمَاءَ وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا بَاطِلًا. طبعا this is after the story of Dawood. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned story of Dawood, story of Sulaiman, and the story of Ayyub. Then the story of Adam comes at the end. And this has a hikmah. Story of Adam did not come first. It came to the end. Because we are talking about the day of judgment, right? So Allah Azza wa Jal want to bring you back to the beginning to prove the end. Okay, so always talk to you, and then he said, now back to the first point we're talking about, right? And the conclusion is such and such. You know, this proves the introduction I gave you, right? Like that. So, now. So Allah Azza wa Jal gives those stories for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to give him peace of mind and heart, comfort of the heart, that you are not alone in this. Okay? And we have prophets, we send prophets who had lots of ni'mah and they were thankful, or lots of tests and they were patient. So thank Allah, Ya Muhammad, for all the ni'mah that He gave you, and be patient on the adha or the harm of these people. So that is the whole point of it. And for us also to learn. So after Allah Azza wa Jalla gave the story of Dawood, then Allah gave few ayahs to prove the power of Allah and the creation of Allah, that it was not created for no reason but for a reason, to worship Him and worship Him alone. Then Allah Azza wa Jalla gave the story of Sulaiman, who is the son of Dawood. Alright? So Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَمَا خَلَقْنَا, we have not created, السَّمَاءَ وَالْأَرْضِ, the heaven and earth, وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا, and whatever in between, بَاطِلَ. Batil means falsehood, but غير الحق, يعني opposite to حق. حق means truth. Batil means falsehood. And batil also means nonsense. You know, when you said هذا كلام باطل, those words have no basis, baseless, does not lead you anywhere. Alright? So batil. حجة باطلة. This argument is batil, void. So what Allah is saying here, that we have not created heavens and earth for no reason. There is a reason. Like the end of Surah Al-Mu'minun, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. So here Allah says, heavens and earth and whoever, whatever in between, including us, يعني, not created, عبث. عبث means no reason, nonsense, يعني, absurd. عبث. عبث means absurd. He said, هذا فلان يعبث. يعبث means he's no reason. That's why if somebody like sitting, khutbah is going on, and they're sitting playing with the phone and, you know, playing with their watch and like these kind of things, هذا يعبث. اسمه عبث هذا. عبث means this is not the time and this is not the job you should be doing now. What you should be doing now, while you are sitting? Learning. So pay attention and ask Allah Azza wa Jal to benefit you and have intention to work upon this. That is the haqq. Anything else becomes abath, right? So Allah created heavens and earth for what reason? To serve us. So Allah created us for what reason? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, to worship me. I have not created jinn or ins to, except to worship me. So our creation is not abath. Creation of heavens and earth is not abath. Creation of animals is not abath. Creation of water is not abath. Creation of hurricanes and earthquakes is not abath. Suffering of some people and all of this zulm and all of that is not abath. All of it is in the ultimate hikmah of Allah. Don't astaghfirullah, yani what I'm going to say. Don't deal with Allah Azza wa Jal as He is a defendant, has to explain Himself to you. Who are you? And who is He? لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. If Allah has to explain Himself, everybody comes every now and then, a little child comes and they say, why Allah is doing this? Why Allah living like that? Oh, if you know who's Allah, you would not ask that question. لله الأمر من قبل ومن بعد. For Allah, لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون. Allah not to be asked, otherwise He's not Allah. If you going to be bringing Him down, explain yourself to me, otherwise it doesn't make sense. Astaghfirullah. أعوذ بالله. Submit يا أخي, submit. Say سمعنا وأطعنا. يا الله حوالينا ولا علينا. يا الله make it, you know, not to affect us. Don't make this fitna for us. يا الله save us. That is the عبودية of Allah, to trust His decision سبحانه وتعالى, even if it is something you cannot comprehend or fathom. That is the true عقيدة. This is the true توحيد of Allah يا أخواني, is to submit to Allah and accept and ask Him سبحانه وتعالى not to affect you in your deen. ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا. يا الله don't make our مصيبة in our deen. Anything else we don't want it, but if it comes, يا الله He will find us صابرين and make us among the شهداء if we die. See, so surrendering to Allah عز وجل. So we have not created heavens and earth out of battle for no reason. This is the belief of the kuffar. ذلك ظن الذين كفروا فويل للذين كفروا من النار. So Allah عز وجل saying, first, I have not created heavens and earth except for a reason. Those who think that they are created for no reason are the kuffar. And the kuffar woe to them from hellfire. It's a warning. You still have a chance. Change your belief, you are not among the kuffar, hence you are not going to fire. Is that understood? Yeah. Then Allah Azza wa Jal says that belief itself is wrong. Yani the ayat saying that is wrong. And this is at the next degree of debate. First, you prove the statement wrong. You say, you know what? If your statement is right, there will be another wrong. You see? First, negate the statement. Void it, right? And then, don't give the person chance to come back, rebuttal, right? Said, you know what? If we assume your thing is right, then there is an issue with it. Because a person who is defeated always will come try to inflict harm even though they know they are wrong. Okay? So you still said, you know what? What is wrong with that? Let me tell you what is wrong with that. أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَالْمُفْسِدِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَمْ نَجْعَلُ الْمُتَّقِينَ كَالْفُجَّارِ If the heavens and earth and what is in between created for no reason, that means after everybody dies, everybody's dust, خلاص, right? There is nothing after that. What is wrong with this belief? Means what is the point of doing anything good? What is the point? There are mufsideen, people who corrupt on earth, and people who are trying to fix the corruption on earth. Why they waste the time? If everybody at the end, خلاص, death is the end of it, then what? Somebody kept corrupting and getting away with it, and then they died. And somebody spent all his life getting harmed, right? And then they die. So what is the point here? What is wrong with that picture? Logically, it's not acceptable. We as humans will not accept that. Would you? Would you accept this? You have two neighbors. One of them is like, you know, harming you every single day. And one of them is defending you every single day. And both die. You feel the same? That both got in trouble. You feel the same? That both got good stuff. You will feel the same? You will not feel the same at all. If both of them get upgrade, you're not happy. Why this guy get upgrade? He's harming me every single day. And this guy deserve it. Why they both getting the same? And if they both get trouble, say, Subhanallah, this guy is so good. Why he's in trouble, you know? This guy deserves to be in jail. Why this guy also have to? And if both of them die, you said, La hawla la quwwata. This guy was defending me and this guy was... So it's like that. That's human nature. Human nature also want the thawab wal iqab. We want thawab wal iqab. We want reward and punishment. You want to be rewarded when you do good. And you are afraid to be punished and get caught. Right? You get caught when you do wrong. You are afraid. So we have that. That's why I always tell people in my training, when I go to schools and they say, we want to give rewards to all the children. I said, that's غير صحيح هذا. That's not good. And another person said, you know, they should go to the competition for Allah's sake. No reward for anybody. I said, that's wrong too. That's wrong too. Someone who did their best and memorized and did the surah better than anyone should get a reward and a trophy. And nobody else get. What's wrong with that? Oh, but the other kids will not feel good, will it? I said, هذا ظنك. This is the way we raise our children. It is wrong, ya akhwani. It's wrong. It is wrong. Let them compete, subhanallah. Let them compete and give them reward for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the others also reward and the others give them kalima tayyiba. Said, you did not, inshallah, you don't become like this. You do extra and you can be next time. And I know it is in you, this tajji' and good. Reward, it's value of any reward. Pay attention to this. The value of any reward is in the fact that not everybody can get it. The more exclusive it is, the more valuable. Do you think or not? Do you think what I'm saying is right or not? The more exclusive, you know, they go to Olympics. Gold medal is not the same like silver medal, not the same like bronze, not the same like coming back without one. Why? It's just a medal, yani, right? But the whole point is exclusivity of it. Everyone competing for that honor, right? Now, if everybody goes to the Olympics and gets a gold medal, you tell me what's going to happen in the competitions. Everybody sucks. Everybody wrong. who trains and who wants to break record and who does? Who wants to do anything? Who wants to do anything? Tell me who. McCullough same, right? Everybody says you gotta get the gold medal. So why should I go, man? It's not Olympics anymore. It's not Wimbledon for tennis anymore, right? There are levels. This is the Masters. This is that. Sahih. The Quran same. Muttaqin not kalfujjar. Like corrupt people, they cannot be the same. Mufsidin not kal muslihin, right? The ones who fix is not like Muslimin, not like mu'minin, not like muhsinin, not like muttaqin, not like mukhlasin. Shuf? There are stages. وفي ذلك فليتنافس المتنافسون. Compete. وسارعوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم. سابقوا إلى. Compete. Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying. Shuf? Very important. You can give a certificate of recognition, but trophy has to go to the winner. Trophy has to go to the winner. Subhanallah, this is very important. So it's not. So Allah Azza wa Jalla said we cannot make this one like that one, and there has to be hisab. So this proves Yawm al Qiyamah. Because of that, Allah gave us salah, siyam, zakah, wa hajj, all of that. Some people will do, some people will not do. Some people will do it right, some people will do it wrong. All of this is a further proof that there is something called Yawm al-Qiyamah. Otherwise, all of this doesn't make sense, right? That is the argument. You deny Yawm al-Qiyamah, you deny the oneness of Allah, there's something wrong with it. Everybody will be equal according to your argument, which is wrong. But if we agree it is right, then who's going to reward and who's going to? So there has to be Allah, there has to be Yawm al-Qiyamah. And because there is Allah, because it's Yawm al-Qiyamah, you need a prophet with a message to teach you about both. You see how eloquent the style is? In two ayahs only. Proves everything for you. You deny Allah, you say Prophet Muhammad doesn't deserve, you know Yawm al-Qiyamah. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, there are good people, there are bad people. You agree? Yes, we agree. If both end is the same and nobody is accountable, is this a good thing? No. That means there has to be Yawm al-Qiyamah. And Yawm al-Qiyamah, there have to be Allah Azza wa Jalla to judge. And for you to know both, there has to be a messenger to teach you about. Here you go. Then, okay. They cannot argue back. So now if they disbelieve, their disbelief is not because they are ignorant. They disbelief because they are arrogant. And that's how you prove an argument. Learn that, brothers. Learn that very well. When you make an argument, you make a statement and say those who disbelieve in that statement are wrong. And why? And then you say, if they are right, the argument would be voided because of such and such and such. That takes lots of study, by the way. That takes lots of sessions. Lots of eagerness, lots of books to read, lots of ulama to ask. It takes a lot. It's not simple and easy. All right? The easy part is to do your worship alone, yani by yourself. But the hard one is to represent and defend. Allah Azza wa Jal, Saint Rasulullah, Kitabun anzalnahu ilayka mubarak. This book is blessed. Quran. Blessing of Allah. Mubarak from barakah. But subhanallah comes an ayah that shows us it is not only reciting and finishing it over and over and over and listening to it over and over and over. No, it has to be لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ, so they can ponder upon, meditate on, reflect on the ayat. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ أَفَلَا يَتَدَّبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ. Allah said, why they are أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا, or there are padlocks on their hearts. أَفَلَا يَتَدَّبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ, don't they ponder upon the ayat of the Quran? وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ, if it is from other than Allah, لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا, they would have found lots of inconsistencies and lot of discrepancies in it. But because it's from Allah, it doesn't have that. Straight. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, شِفَاء, no doubt in it. شِفَاء, healing, cure. هُدًى, guidance. رَحْمَة, mercy. مَوْعِظَة, admonition. Right? That is the Quran. هِدَايَة for you. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ, and those will be reminded are the ones who have the core of understanding. lub is the core of everything. Lub is the core of everything. Al-bab means cores, right, of different principles. You have sadr, your chest. Then you have al-qalb, which is the heart. Then you have al-fu'ad, which is the ability to process things. And then you have the lub, which reach the truth. You know, that's why whenever you find ulul al-bab, it is always the end result, the value, the essence of your deen. That is the lub of things. You know, there is an exercise in psychology. Whenever you want to get a core value of someone, you ask them like this, right? Like this. You want to buy a house, let's say, right? Let me do this exercise with my student here, Muhammad. Don't worry, it's a nice exercise, right? You are in high school, right? Why?
To learn.
To learn, right? So you just said, the reason for you being in high school is to learn. Why you want to learn?
So I can get a higher education.
And when you get a higher education, what you going to do with that?
Get a job.
Okay, you got a job. Why you want to get a job?
To support a family.
Support a family. Then once the family is supported, then everything is cool. Why you want
to
do that?
To live happily.
So happiness is your ultimate goal, right? What comes out of happiness? Actually, happiness would be the last one for someone regular, yani. But we as Muslims go beyond that, right? But let's stop at happiness. So his ultimate goal or his core value is what here? That's what drives him to do everything. And I have to state that in his head. So now you have to ask yourself before you do anything, Muhammad, is it going to make me happy or not? After you define what happiness means. You see, that's called the core value. That's an exercise, right? Now, the Quran is inviting us, actually, every single ayah to do that. Would this make you reach to Allah or not? وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا to worship Allah. You agree with this one or not? You agree? Yeah, so everything you do, said, is this ibadah of Allah or not? Does this please Allah or not? So now your main value is to please Rabbul Alameen. When you wake up in the morning, what's my ultimate goal today? So everything you will do will answer that question for you. Am I pleasing Allah or not? Because if you do an action mistakenly, which is displeasing to Allah, what would be the next thing you do? Astaghfirullah. Alatul. Right? If you don't have that core value, you will be lost. You get it? Ah. So Allah Azza wa Jalla here saying, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتْدَبَّرُوا آيَاتِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرُوا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. So what is the purpose of Quran? Tadabbur and tadhakkur. So you can ponder and reach a result, it reminds you. So every ayah should remind you of something. Correct you if you're wrong, improve you if you are right. Is that clear? So lub is the core. The ability to reach the core value. That's ulul albab. May Allah make us among ulul. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ Creation of the earth. وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ The alteration of day and night. لَآيَاتٍ لَهُ لأولي الألباب. Who are أولي الألباب you want to reach? الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا. They remember Allah. They say this dua and they do this end of Surah Al-Imran. You want to be among أولي الألباب? Follow the prescription. Those are steps you want among أولي الألباب. Once you become from أولي الألباب, may Allah make us all among them, then the message is very clear. It comes to you, you know exactly what to do. Before that, there is lots of confusion. So what is your dua? Ya Allah, make me among ulul albab and follow the prescription. Then comes the story of Sulaiman, which is easy, inshallah. Will not take too long in it, because too long means you deviate on the Israelites and all of that. Like we did for the story of Dawood alayhi salam. Story of Dawood alayhi salam, they say the two people came, Dawood make mistake, this and that, which is not true, by the way. Same thing, all the stories that you find in the tafsir of the story of Sulaiman, they are not correct. Shocker, but yeah, and that's all those details come because of that. Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَوَهَبْنَا لِدَاوُودَ سُلَيْمَانَ نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ إِنَّهُ أَوَّابُ. Allah Azza wa Jal said, and we gifted وَهَبَ هِبَ يعني gift from Allah. Allah gifted Dawood, because he's good servant, with Sulaiman. So it is praising both. You got a gift That means you are special. And you got a precious gift. That means the gift is precious. Right? So Sulaiman has a value, alayhi salam, and Dawood has a value, alayhi salam, in the same ayah. So still Allah talking about Dawood, but this is paving the way to talk about Sulaiman. Ni'ma al-abd, it can be Dawood or Sulaiman, but it is better to be Sulaiman because Dawood was praised already before, right? So wahabna li Dawood Sulaiman, because Dawood is a good man, we give him Sulaiman. Or wahabna li Dawood Sulaiman, who became a good servant as well. You can understand the ayah either way, right? وَوَهَبْنَا لِدَاوُودَ سُلَيْمَانَ نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ. There are two subjects here. نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ can go to either one or both. نِعْمَ الْعَبْدُ إِنَّهُ أَوَّابٌ. He comes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or that means he make istighfar after عصر, between عصر and مغرب. أواب يعني. Or after مغرب. في صلاة اسمها صلاة الأوابين. يعني you pray, you know, two ركعة, two ركعة, like that. So awab means returning back to Allah all the time. Not necessarily because he did a mistake. Because having that premise will give way to mistakes on the prophet, for the prophets, and this is not right. يعني. They are infallible, right? نعم العبد إنه أواب. He comes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah Azza Jal mentioned two things that happened to Sayyidina Sulaiman, proving that he always returns back to Allah. Returning back to Allah doesn't mean he did a mistake, my brothers. And that's where many of the Mufassirin or many of the Israelites were adopted by Mufassirin, having that premise, a web that means he did a mistake and he goes back to Allah Azza Jal because of it. And they mentioned the two stories I'm going to say now as two mistakes he repented to Allah from, which is not necessarily the case. Right? So like they said, Dawood alayhi salam made a judgment before he listened to both. That is a major sin. For a prophet is a problem, you know. You cannot accuse a prophet with that. No, that was not the case. Ayyub, Dawood alayhi salam, when he realized that Allah is teaching him a lesson, he prostrated to Allah. Not necessarily because he realized that he made a mistake. Okay? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I seek Allah's forgiveness every day more than 70 times and more than 100 times in another narration. What does that mean? He make mistakes, yani, or what? No. Alright? Always you feel that you are mistakes. Mistaking, or if you feel you are falling short of praising Allah Azza Jal. That's why we do istighfar, not necessarily because we did a mistake that we are aware of. Allah Azza Jal said, إِذْ عُرِضَ عَلَيْهِ بِالْعَشِيِّ الصَّافِنَاتُ الْجِيَادِ. At the end of the day, after عصر, there was a military parade. You know the parade? You know, military, what they call it when the general is standing and all the army goes in front? Parade? Parading? Huh? Like he's seeing his troops, yani. Parade, military parade, and he's seeing, yani, the every army, they do that to show the other opponents what they are able of, and also for the leader to check and review. Okay? So Sulaiman alayhi salam was doing jihad here everywhere, he's controlling and sending, you know, troops and inviting people to the deen of Allah and all of that. And this khayl or this horses, safinat al-jihad, yani horses, very pure horses, like what we call Arabian horses now. This is way before that. So he is reviewing that or seeing that in front of him in the parade. Safinat, you know, the Arabian horses, and I don't know if there is other horses or not, there has one characteristic to prove the purity of the breed. When they run very fast, and you can barely see their hooves touching the ground. It's like flying, right? Is flying. So that's when they are, that is jiyad, al-jiyad. That's the part al-jiyad, yani. When they are running, al-jiyad, min al-jawad, yani they run smoothly and fast in a beautiful, amazing, elegant, graceful manner. And where they are standing? They stand only on 3 feet, on three, and the fourth is only touching with the hoof the ground. You can imagine the picture? Only Arabian horses do that. So when they are standing still, they are standing in that graceful manner. Three, you know, of their legs stable on the ground, and the fourth is like, the hoof is like up like this. It's beautiful. You see the pictures? Always giving you the Arabian horse with the head like, you know, tilted a little bit. You know, it has that arch, right? And then, you know, you see the hooves barely touching, and their nose is like so beautiful like this. This is amazing, yani, graceful. And Allah Azza wa Jal made qasam with the horses. والعاديات ضبحا فالموريات قدحا فالمغيرات صبحا فأثرن به نقعا فوسطن به جمعا. All of this about horses. Making قسم with it سبحانه وتعالى. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم said خير, the goodness and the wealth is in the foreheads of the horses when it goes في سبيل الله في الجهاد يعني and all that في سبيل الله سبحان الله. And the رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم took many hadith in Bukhari that whoever have a faras or a horse for في سبيل الله عز وجل, الله عز وجل with every drop of water even with the waste that comes out of it, الله عز وجل give reward to that person. With the rope, every step it goes in the rope, Allah gives the reward to that person, subhanAllah. So khair, huh? That's why Sulaiman alayhi salam said, حب الخير, يعني the love of the horses. So he is reviewing those horses, and they started racing in front of him. And there were too many. Some of the narrations said 20, some of the narrations 20,000. Some of the narrations said, but all of this narration doesn't matter for us anyways. But because there are too many, until it went far away from him and the dust and all that covered it. So he said, bring it back again. He wanted to check. رُدُّوهَا عَلَيَّ. He wanted to see. And then he started, after they did the race and the parade, he started wiping on the horses, appreciating the ni'mah of Allah. فَطَفِقَ مَسْحًا بِالسُّوقِ وَالْأَعْنَاقِ. You know, started, you know, like, you know, patting the horses on their necks and on their, you know, legs, you know, four legs, four arms, right? He started wiping. And this is the petting of the horse, making the horse feel good, and also appreciating the ni'mah of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So like bonding with them. So that is the right tafsir. He is doing that. حتى توارت بالحجاب, until it disappeared, the description for the horses. Now there is an Israelite story, even Ibn Kathir mentioned it, but people misunderstand, they go, said Ibn Kathir mentioned that, but at the end Ibn Kathir said most of those stories are weak. So people read three pages, but they forget to read that line at the end, right? So they say, oh, Ibn Kathir mentioned this, Ibn Kathir mentioned that, well, go read again, right? But have a big magnifying glass with you to find that word in the middle, you know, that's how scholarly, you know, ulama used to be. So anyways, so they say, oh, he was supposed to pray Asr, but then he got busy with the horses, okay? And when the tawarat bil hijab means until the sun set, while he did not pray, because he was busy with this, and then he said, bring the horses back, and he start killing them. He cut the necks of the horses, and break the legs of the horses with his sword. Mashan, يعني بالسوق والأعناق, يعني he started cutting their necks and their own, and then he gives sadaqah their meat. Tab, what did the horse do wrong? A prophet يعني will transgress the horses? Why? Why يعني transgress horses? It's his mistake, if we assume, right? It's his mistake, not the horse's mistake. Why he punish the horses? Okay? So there are يعني stories like that, but since we don't have a clear cut statement from Allah or from his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, always you deal with the Prophet as a Prophet of Allah Azza wa Jal. Unless Allah told us that Musa alayhi salam killed the man, فَوَكَزَهُ مُوسَى فَقَضَى عَلَيْهِ, we would not say that Musa can kill anybody, but Allah Azza wa Jal said that this happened. Did Musa intend to kill him? No. But then he repented to Allah. So a messenger can do something wrong, but Allah Azza wa Jal fixes it and he goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is the only one who tells us that this happened. Like Yunus alayhi salam. Like, you know, those kind of stories we only believe from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or from our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that's the first story. Then Allah said, وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا سُلَيْمَانِ, we tested Sulaiman. وَأَلْقَيْنَا عَلَىٰ كُرْسِيهِ جَسَدًا ثُمَّ أَنَابَ. أَلْقَيْنَا عَلَىٰ كُرْسِيهِ جَسَدًا, يعني a body is on his chair, on his seat of mulk, يعني. Okay? Or made him sick. That means made him sick, like Ayyub alayhi salam, which is the correct chosen by يعني, the ulama. That Sulaiman alayhi salam, not only he had it all without any test in his body, but Allah made him sick also until he became so weak. So he asked Allah Azza wa Jal to relieve him from that. And then when Allah relieved him from that, Allah gave him all the kingship that he asked for. Like the Ayyub alayhi salam, he became patient, and then he asked Allah, Allah give him more than what he had, double what he had before, right? So Sulaiman alayhi salam also went through the same, but he had it all before, and he had it all and more after. And in the middle, Allah tested him as well. Short test, yeah, right? وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا سُلَيْمَانَ وَأَلْقَيْنَ عَلَىٰ كُرْسِيهِ. طبعاً there are stories that saying all the mulk of Sulaiman was in his ring. خَتْم Sulaiman, the ring of Sulaiman, He does everything. Why he needs a ring? I don't know. Right? If a prophet of Allah, he can just make a dua. Why you need a ring, yani? Like, you know, power, you know, my ring. Be careful of the ring. Yani, I don't know, but a story like this, right? So his mulk, all his power was in his ring. Yeah. So one time he, because the ring has the name of Allah, the Great, and all that, so when he entering al-hammam, he takes it off, he give it to someone, so one of his wives, so a shaitan come in the picture of Sulaiman, he took the ring, she thought it's her husband, and he started sitting on the seat of Sulaiman. Sulaiman come out with a different shape, nobody believed him, huh? And then he goes and things like that, right? Like, you know, this Hollywood kind of movies, yani, right? So it's there in the books. Ajeeb Allah. Yani, a prophet of Allah, Allah tested him like this? Put a shaitan in his seat to rule the people, yani? Is this kind of, is this the test, yani? Yaliq bin Nabi? Yaliq billah Azza wa Jal, yani, ni'mal kada? Is this good? Yani, is this something that befitting to Allah Azza wa Jal? Is this a test to Sulaiman? Walla confusion to everybody, yani? Who's going to teach people the deen then? If they're saying shaitan is a Sulaiman, becomes shaitan, yani? Type, that's one. The other one, there is a story in Sahih al-Bukhari, but al-Bukhari did not say it is the tafsir of this ayah. So I'm warning, yani, before, right? So Bukhari did not say that this is the tafsir of this ayah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one time he said, Sulaiman alayhi salam, he said, I am going to, today, yani, the day and the night, I'm going to go have a relationship with 70 wives. This was allowed, yani, to have 100 wives or whatever. So 70 wives, and each one of them will, inshallah, give birth. He did not say inshallah, yani, will give birth to someone who jahid fi sabilillah. Yani, will go and ride a horse and fi sabilillah. So what's his intention? Serving Allah. I want to have 70 boys, 70 children. And he did not say inshallah. So none of them became pregnant. None of them had, except one give like a deformed creature who died later, yani, right? So Allah Azza wa Jal, yani, this is the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasul said, وَلَوْ قَالَ إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ لَكَانُوا كُلُّهُمْ فُرْسَانًا. If he said inshallah, it would have been exactly what he asked for. But he did not say inshallah. So that also to show us, Allah taught Rasulullah himself, yani, he told him, وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا. That's why when he told him, tomorrow I will answer you, wahi stopped. Right? And then later on it came. So anyways, this is a learning process for the prophets and for everybody. Subhanallah. And they don't hide that. That proves their prophethood. Right? عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّ أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. You shouldn't have done that. And the Rasulullah ﷺ delivered it to us. Because he's a prophet. Okay? So anyways, this is another story. But Rasul ﷺ did not say it is the tafsir of this ayah. Al-Bukhari did not say it is the tafsir of this ayah. But some of the scholars said this is the tafsir of that. Again, there is no base. I'm just giving you the two. One extreme saying shaitan took over and all of that, right? And one saying that this hadith is the tafsir of this ayah which has no base. So basically the base is the literal understanding of this ayah that Sayyidina Sulaiman was sick and Allah Azza wa Jal healed him. That's why he said, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَهَبْ لِي مُلْكَ. رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي, it doesn't mean that he made a mistake. Sayyidina Ayyub, when he became sick, he said, رَبِّ إِنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بِنُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ. Shaitan touched me. Is the shaitan one who made him sick? No, Allah is the one who made him sick, but he does not want to attribute it to Allah. Now, because he got sick, he thinking that maybe, ya Allah, because I did something wrong, that I became sick, so forgive me. And that's why, you know, when you are sick, ask Allah forgiveness. It's not because you are saying I did wrong, but that's why I'm sick. But always have adab with Rabbul Alameen. Adab, adab. You know, adab, etiquette with Allah, polite. That means, ya Allah, it is because of my own wrongdoing. My own wrongdoing, my own shortcoming. Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَمَا أَصَابَكُمْ مِنْ مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُ عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. Whatever happens to you is because of what you do. But Allah forgives many. يعني He does not punish us with everything that we do. وَلَوْ يُؤَخِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ بِمَا كَسَبُوا مَا تَرَكَ عَلَى ظَهْرِهَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ. أخوان, Allah said it in the Quran, if Allah account us or punish us with everything we do, there will be no life form on the face of earth. You see how much wrong we do? وَلَوْ يُؤَخِذُ اللَّهُ النَّاسَ بِظُلْمِهِمْ مَا تَرَكَ عَلَيْهَا مِنْ دَابَّةِ يعني if Allah account people with their ظلم all the time, they will be wiped out. Now understand? Yeah, so he said, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي. Maybe I did something wrong, that's why you tested me, Allah. And هَبَلِي مُلْكًا لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِّنْ بَعْدِي. Someone will ask, why Sayyidina Sulaiman wanted more? And he doesn't want anybody to be like him. The scholar, subhanAllah, because he's a prophet of Allah, messenger of Allah, they said he did not want anybody to have power, so they misuse it. He want to have all the power above everybody so he can use it fi sabilillah. And it's good to ask Allah for more ni'mah if you know that you can use it fi sabilillah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what Allah says, we give him what he asked. فَسَخَّرْنَا لَهُ الْرِيحِ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَابِ. When you want to ask Allah with the name relevant to what you need. You have a problem in your rizq, Allahumma anta al-aati, al-mu'ati, al-raziq, al-razzaq, al-fattah, al-wahhab. You see the ayat of the names of Allah, all about rizq, giving. Right? If someone, and this is true, يعني, one time I'm walking with a sheikh. Right? I'm walking with a sheikh. And that sheikh, he started speeding when we were in the hajj time. يعني, he started speaking to go to the hotel. I said, sheikh, يعني, slow down. He said, I have diarrhea, Sheikh. I wanted to run, you know? And then he started saying, Ya Qabid, Ya Qabid. Allah al Qabid, right? Qabid means the one withholding, right? He said, Ya Qabid, Ya Qabid. And I started laughing. I said, Ya Sheikh, please make sure you don't say Ya Basit. So, Ya Qabid, Al Qabd, Yaqbidu, Wallahu Yaqbidu, wa Yabasutu. So, if you want Allah to extend more, said Ya Basit, Ya Basit. If you want Allah to withhold something, he said what? Ya Qabil. So that's one the story. طيب. So you ask. So Allah, Sayyidina Sulaiman said, Innaka anta al-wahhab. You are the one who gives hiba. Habili mulkan, innaka anta al-wahhab. She is asking, Habili wahhab. Iftahli fattah. Allimni ya alim. Ubsutli ya basit. You understand? انصرني يا ناصر استرني يا ستير. شوف always you want the dignity. اللهم يا عزيز اعزني. Right? اعزني, give me the عزة. Always ask Allah with that name. And actually there is one opinion of the scholars that the greatest name of Allah is the name that you need. If you find the name that is most accurate to your need, that is the greatest name of Allah for that purpose. That's one opinion. So Allah said, سَخَّرْنَا فَسَخَّرْنَا لَهُ الْرِيحِ. الْرِيحِ, the wind. تَجْرِي بِأَمْرِهِ رُخَاءً. يعني very malleable. He orders it to do. So it is not cool breeze, does not take him anywhere, and it is not stormy. It is رُخَاءً. حَيْثُ أَصَاب. Wherever he wants, with the speed he likes. Cruise, you know, cruise control. That is the wind. With the speed that he likes. Let's go faster. Yes. Let's go slower. Yes. Up, down, this, that. Subhanallah. سَخَّرْنَا لَهُ الْرِيحَ تَجْرِي بِأَمْرِهِ بِأَمْرِهِ. With his order. Allah said, follow Sulaiman's order. Subhanallah. حَيْثُ أَصَاب. Whatever he wants. وَالشَّيَاطِينَ. يعني the disobedient one among the jinns, the bad ones, they are under his control too. كل بناء وغواص. They built huge palaces with his permission, and they go to the deepest of oceans to get him the pearls and the rarest of gems. Go do this. Yes. طيب. What if they disobey or not going? مقرنين في الأصفاد. He's going to chain them and put them and they cannot release themselves with all the superpowers, right? They cannot. So Sulaiman عليه السلام had that power, subhanallah. Allah told him, هَذَا عَطَاؤُنَا. This is what we are able to give you. فَمْنُنْ أَوْ أَمْسِكْ. Give whomever you wish and hold whatever you wish. براحتك يعني give whatever you want, يا سليمان. We give you the authority to do that. Autonomy, full autonomy on whom you give and whom you don't give. Subhanallah. هَذَا عَطَاؤُنَا. This is what we give you. فَمْنُنْ أَوْ أَمْسِكْ بَغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ وَإِنَّ لَهُ عِنْدَنَا لَزُلْفَ. A special status and special access from Sulaiman عليه السلام to Allah means he's close to us. وَحُسْنَ مَآبِ الْجَنَّةِ في يوم القيامة. Subhanallah, to finish this lecture, we learn a few things, subhanallah, that from the fadl of Allah alayhi, fadl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on Dawood alayhi salam, is that he gave him too many things, and among those gifts is to give him a son called Sulaiman. So it is the ni'mah of Allah not only to make you happy but to give you a good child. So also ask Allah Azza wa Jal to give you a good child to become better than you, to feel the legacy, to follow the legacy of being a Muslim, not legacy of being whatever you are or having money. This is beside the point. These are things to make you happy. Huh? These are the things to make you happy, pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, but this is not the purpose. So your purpose is what? What bring you happiness as a Muslim? What will make a Muslim happy? That you please Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everything you do, make sure it goes to that goal. That's your common value. From the ni'mah of Allah on Sulaiman alayhi salam is that he gave him all this power over all these things, subhanahu alayhi salam. Allah gave him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, Allah tests the best of his servants. So if Allah tests you, don't object. Always accuse yourself and ask Allah forgiveness. So whenever Allah gives you something, use it for the sake of Allah. Allah takes it away from you, said, Ya Allah, forgive me. Maybe I did something wrong. But don't say why. Okay? Clear? Please. You say why, shaitan plays with it. Don't. Ya Allah, you are the one who gives. Ya Allah, you are the one who take. Please keep my religion. Keep my heart firm, Ya Allah. And forgive me if I did anything wrong. You see? This is the abd of Allah. Ni'ma al-abd. Innahu awwab. Also, we learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala respond to the dua of the salihin as well. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah give you. And if Allah give you less than what you are asking, it's for the hikmah of Allah. This is the best for you. If Allah doesn't give you at all, He is saving it for you. If Allah give you what you want, you should be thankful to Allah. If Allah give you more, you should actually do more. So all scenarios, you are a servant of Allah. If you don't get what you are asking, you know it is Allah's wisdom and you be patient. If Allah gives you less than what you ask, you say that means the hikmah of Allah, that's what I need. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. If Allah gives you exactly what you are asking, you should say thank you Allah and you start acting accordingly, it's a responsibility. If Allah gives you more than what you ask, you should actually do more and thank more. Be afraid that you can lose it because He gives you more, He can put you under the line. So be careful when you are dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This brings us to the end of today's section. May Allah Azza wa Jalla benefit us of what we said and what we heard, and may Allah teach us what benefits us. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.